Hey y'all, it's Sammy with Avid CNC, and today we'll be focusing on a great way to get started if you're new to CNC, by making a Coliseum. This is a great introductory CNC project. As Corey on our support team likes to say, running a CNC is like playing an instrument. We don't start with Stairway to Heaven. We have to learn the basics and chords that give you the confidence to set up and run a part from start to finish. If you're already comfortable on the CNC, we'd recommend our 10-step cycle start checklist for a shorter best practice video. It's linked in the description below. We'll go through the whole process from basic work holding to machine setup and give an introduction to a few of our recommended software packages, including Mach 4, our CNC control software, as well as Vectrix VCarve, which we'll be using to design and program our toolpaths. We'll touch briefly on design and programming throughout the video, but stay till the end for a more thorough walkthrough in Vectrix VCarve. The Coliseum was originally designed by Emily Wobb, a Portland-based artist and CNC enthusiast. Thanks, Wobb, for letting us use your design. If you don't have a spoil board yet because this is your first project, that's okay. You can place and clamp a piece of MDF to your cross members, and then attach your material to that temporary spoil board. If you have any questions throughout this process, feel free to contact our support team for assistance. All right, let's get started with our machine setup. First, we'll locate our emergency stop and be sure it's installed in an accessible location. Then we'll turn on our CNC controller and start at Mach 4. Be sure that your Ethernet cable is connected to the controller as well as the computer. Check the description below for instructions on how to install and calibrate Mach 4. Once you have your machine connected, make sure that your keyboard jog is turned on. This way you'll be able to drive the machine around using your keyboard arrows. You can also use the X, Y, and Z jog buttons on the screen set in Mach 4. The first thing to do after you have the machine turned on and communicating with the control computer is to home your machine. Click Home XYZ axes in Mach 4 and your machine will find the machine limits of each axis to establish a repeatable fixed location. Let's talk a little bit about your material setup and work holding. There are a variety of ways to make sure your material is squared to the machine gantry. I have a series of holes drilled into my spoil board that I know are square to the machine. If I insert two dowels, I can push my material edge up against these two points, which will make sure that this edge is parallel to my y-axis. Here I'm using a pneumatic nail gun that shoots composite nails. This is a quick and easy way to attach your material. The polymer composite nails fuse with the material and the spoil board, creating a strong connection that will still be easy to remove later on. Additionally, if my router bit happens to cross paths with a composite nail, it will be able to cut right through it, which would not be the case if it hit a metal fastener. Check the description below for more information on the composite nail gun system and a playlist on work holding techniques. Let's install a router bit into the spindle. Here I'm using a compression router bit. I'll also link to a more in-depth video about router bit selection for plywood in the description. By using a measuring tape, let's be sure that the router bit is mounted into the collet with enough clearance to accommodate the deepest cut, which in this case is the thickness of the material. Now let's get our file prepped to export our G-code. We'll briefly reference our material setup here in VCarve, but stay till the end for a programming walkthrough on how to create your toolpaths. First, let's look into how to set up our work coordinates in our file. I'll go to my material setup and check my zeroing selection. When you're getting started, it's a good idea to keep this consistent. There are many options and reasons to select specific corners or surfaces to reference in your X, Y, and Z zero, but today let's just keep it simple with our zeroing selections. After confirming our material dimensions, let's set the Z zero. You can select the surface of the workpiece or the surface of the spoil board. Let's select the material surface as our Z zero reference. Now let's select our X, Y datum. We can choose any corner of the workpiece or the center of the material. I'll select the front left corner. Great, I'll go to export my toolpaths with my Avid CNC mock post processor. I'll choose 1 in inches. We recommend saving to an easy to find location such as a clearly labeled folder on the desktop and using a memorable file naming convention. Now let's set our zero on the machine in Mach 4. To set our G54 offsets today, we'll be using the Auto Z and Corner Finding Touch Plate. This is a great tool for quick and easy zeroing. We'll set the touch plate on the corner of the material that we selected to be our XY datum, with the wall side of the touch plate flush against the edge of our material. Drive the spindle over so that it's centered about 1 inch above the brass plate. Then attach the magnet. In Mach 4, we'll select the touch plate icon. Always be sure to set the router bit diameter whenever you're setting an X or Y zero. It is also best practice to have the ESOP handy when using the touch plate, especially the first time. Then select the matching image for your datum selection. We'll use the front left corner. When you click this button, the router bit will begin to lower for a Z touch off. The program will then pause and prompt you to rotate the router bit so the cutting edge of the bit is facing the Y wall, or away from you. When you click OK, it will move in that direction. This is an important step because the cutting edge represents the true diameter of the bit. If the wall were to contact the inner flute rather than the cutting edge, the reading will not be accurate. Rotate again for the X wall and click OK. Great, now we have our zero set to the front left and top corner of the material. Let's go ahead and turn on our spindle controller. Make sure that the area around the spindle is clear of debris, tools, and hands. Have the e-stop nearby and ready as well. In Mach 4, we'll click the spindle on button to be sure that the controller and VFD are communicating correctly. Click off to stop. Let's load our G-code into Mach 4. As you can see in the preview window on the top right, we can see our toolpaths. You can now install the dust shoe and turn the dust collection on. I'll leave the dust shoe off so you can have a better view. We're close to being ready to hit cycle start in Mach 4. This is a good point to review your 10-step cycle start checklist to be absolutely sure you have your machine and program set up correctly. Check the description below for the checklist video. After you've gone through your checklist, hit cycle start. As you get more comfortable running your machine and learning different techniques, you'll find that this video lays out one of many possible solutions and processes. You'll be able to decide which solution is best as you introduce more variables. If you're machining acrylic or aluminum instead of plywood, then this will alter your selections of work holding, router bits, and feeds and speeds. You'll also consider different CAM and CAD programs depending on the type and geometry of the part you're designing. Many of our customers use Fusion 360 for CAD and CAM, as well as Rhino. Other folks choose to design in SketchUp, Cabinet Parts Pro or Mosaic, and program the toolpaths in Vectric products such as VCarve and Aspire. Vectric also offers a variety of CAD CAM packages with focuses on different features and tiers that are really great options as well. I'll drive the gantry out of the way and tap the side of the material with a mallet to break the composite nails. You can cut the tabs with a handsaw, jigsaw, flush trim bit on a hand router, or whatever tool you'd prefer. We'll flush trim these on the router table or just sand them down with the belt sander. I'll use a few dowels to align my steps here and glue it all together. We'll be right back. After some sanding and finish, I can install my bits for easy storage. Always remember, what we do in life echoes in eternity. Thanks everyone for watching. We'll see you in the Colosseum. Are you not entertained? Welcome to our VCarve walkthrough. We also highly recommend Vectric's channel for more amazing tutorials on their software. All right, let's get started. I'll open a new project. First, we can select our project type. I'll choose a single-sided job. We're going to program this project to be one setup, with one router bit selected to accomplish every task. While this is not necessarily the way you would approach router bit selection or programming options for this project a year from now, let's just try to focus on the basics and a simple setup for now. We can enter in our material dimensions. I'll just take those measurements directly from the plywood I have handy. 3/4 inch material will work, but 1 inch is better if you have it. 20 by 40 inches will give us about 1 inch border around the edge to accommodate any work holding and the toolpath. As you may understand by now, we need to select our zero reference surfaces. We'll have a video coming out soon about why you might select a specific surface to accomplish a different task. Let's stick to the basics and set the Z0 to the material surface. Make sure that the offsets box is unselected. Our XY datum will be the front left corner. Let's click OK. Now we can import our vectors. Great, now we can rearrange the vectors to fit onto our material. On the left, we have a visual representation of how the parts are from a bird's eye view when they're stacked. Take this into account when you're arranging the parts and programming the cut depths. This would also be a good time to adjust any diameter of the holes if you have more of a certain size router bit in your collection. Just be sure to allow enough tolerance for the bit to be stored easily. I'll select the arcs for the exterior profile through cut. Then on the right toolbar, click the profile toolpath icon. My start depth will be 0. For the cut depth, I can enter Z, which will reference the material thickness I entered in the beginning with the material setup. I'll select the 1/4 inch router bit from the tool library. Here I'll enter and adjust my feeds and speeds. These are settings and adjustments that you'll learn to make over time depending on the machine type, cut quality, chip load, router bit, and material type, even the sound of the machine. These are suggestions and not perfect recipes because there are so many variables when it comes to setting feeds and speeds. I'll set my pass depth to 1/8 inch. Generally, half the diameter of the router bit is a good place to start. I'll set the RPM to 17,000 and the feed rate to 300 inches per minute. And the plunge rate to 60 IPM. We'll click Apply to save those settings and then OK. Then let's select the Edit Passes button. We're going to break our half of the diameter pass depth rule here for the first plunge because we're going to be using a compression bit. I'll delete the first pass so it plunges deeper to accommodate the unique geometry of the bit and prevent tear out. Please take some time to check out the router bit selection video in the description and learn more about why we chose to do this. Then click OK. Let's select the outside profile for our cut. So cuts on the outside of the line. Now let's add a few tabs to our parts to hold to the drop material. I'll adjust the height and width of them to my preference and then select the 3D tab option. These are easier to remove than square tabs, though not as strong. Click Edit Tabs and then click on the vectors to place them. We also have a video on tabs in the description below. Next, we'll add a ramp to our toolpath. I'll choose the smooth option and make the length 2 inches. We can add a lead in here to help with the router bit entry into the material so it contacts the drop material before the edge of the part. You can experiment with these settings as you get more comfortable. We'll select the Start At tab and select our ideal start point. Next, we'll give our toolpaths a memorable name. I'll call it the toolpath type, cut depth, and router bit type. Let's calculate and preview our toolpath. Let's return to the 2D page and make our pocket toolpath. Here we can preview our toolpaths in wireframe, though I prefer viewing in the solid viewing mode. We'll click this button on the top bar to switch. Now let's select the dowel hole groups for each layer, as well as all the holes we want to go all the way through. We won't select any of the vectors on the bottom layer because then the bits would fall through. Here's where you would take the average length of your router bits into consideration. You can have the pockets go through multiple layers if you choose. I'll go ahead and select the holes that I want to be pocketed at the full depth of the material. We'll create the toolpath. This time it will be a pocket. This is very similar to the profile toolpath. I'll set my cut depth to Z thickness. Turn on the advanced toolpath options. I'll select the same quarter inch router bit from the tool library where I saved my previous cut settings. We'll choose an offset machining approach because these are mostly circular shapes. Then name your toolpath and calculate. Let's preview that one too. Great. I'll switch back to my 2D view, then right-click on the vectors and move them to a new layer to make the selection of the remaining circles easier. I can name the layer and give it a color. I'll click on the Layers tab to view the layers. Next, I can select the exterior profiles and put those on their own layer as well. I can click the light bulb icon to turn those layers off. This will make it extremely easy to select the remaining circles. I'll make another pocket toolpath. This time I'll set the cut depth to 1/2 inch deep so that it doesn't cut all the way through the material. I'll go through the same steps as the last pocket. And then give it a name and calculate. Let's preview that toolpath as well. Now I'll rearrange the toolpath so that the profile cut is last. When you save multiple toolpaths together, they'll run in this order. We can reset and preview the final order. Great! Now we can save out our toolpath as shown earlier. Thanks everyone for watching, and I'll see you all in the shop.